trained manpower is prerequisite to quality healthcare delivery. As we move from classroom to blended learning, increased focus on reskilling and upskilling, what is in store for us? Let's listen to our panelists of session 7. Digital healthcare skilling, brand insurance for hospital leaders. Our second chair for this session is Mr. Anurag Seth. Anurag is CTO and partner at Singapore headquarters, the Temso ICT Fund. He brings in 25 plus years experience of deep technology background. Anurag has a unique mix of startup, large enterprise, investment experience, having held senior management position. His startup innovative platform for chronic diabetes care was adopted by one of India's largest pathology lab chains. Our speaker for this session is Mr. Deepak Sharma, Chief Executive Officer, MedLearn. MedLearn is a platform dedicated to getting healthcare workforce better prepared for better care, helping more than 150 hospitals manage the training and talent development need of nearly 35,000 employees in areas of quality, induction, recruitment, soft skills, etc. Deepak is a graduate of IIT Delhi and IIM Calcutta. Is passionate about digital transformation of the global healthcare and life sciences sector and closely tracks development of AI, IoT, blockchain, and other related technologies. Welcome, panel, and I hand over to the chair to start the session.
This is Anurag. Welcome to this session. And there's a little changeover from what we've been hearing since morning. This is an area, skilling is an area which probably is very critical, but it's typically not in the highest priority for most hospitals. Now, I believe there are two elements to it. We saw a brilliant presentation a little while ago on AR, VR, and all these digital technologies encompassing us, right? In the healthcare space, right? And it's fast moving. So I think there are two elements as far as, you know, skilling is concerned. One is how do we, there's a lack of, you know, awareness and lack of skills around, around these digital technologies are so fast coming in and getting adopted. So there's one element of, training our staff, in hospital staff on these newly emerging technologies, AR, VR, AI, all those buzzwords which we're hearing since morning. And the second element, is about how do we leverage the advances in, you know, these technologies, digital technologies, to really do a general skilling, which basically means, you know, continuous skill upgradation of staff. You see, 80% of the, you know, healthcare is basically more increasingly a services business, right? So in that context, where is the service happen? 80% of the, you know, patient experiences with respect to the front end workers in the hospitals, right? So that skilling in terms of how the interaction happens, all the touch points happen, becomes very important. And, you know, standardization of clinical practices, normalization of the professional behavior, including in things like, you know, imbibing key values as you interact with patients and so on, become an important element. So in that context, that skilling becomes a very important element. And how do we leverage the advances in digital technology to skill our workforce, and which also, you know, which will increasingly contribute to the brand awareness, because brands all is not going to be about just advertisement, it's going to be about the patient experience. So without further ado, hand over the stage to Deepak. To share his experience and take it from there.
Hi, thanks for having me here, and thanks for the great introduction, Anurag. You might as well have gone through my entire presentation, but you know, saved me a lot of time. But perfect setting for the rest of the session. The connection between brand assurance and digital healthcare skilling. The first thing people ask me, saying, is there a connection? And let me start with the words of a well-known marketing guru, right? Everybody knows Philip Kotler. Is that there are two ways to get a reputation in the service industry. One is the best at service. The other is to be the worst at service, right? And there's nothing more true in the healthcare sector. Reputations are built and made based on the service experience. And, you know, we looked at a lot of studies in India across the world, and I tried to see if I really need to make a case saying, look, brand experience, patient experience, business growth depends a lot on the service quality. But I think all the research points to a few things, right? Look at hospital factors that drive the choice of providers from patients. And there is all sorts of things there, but recurrent themes with no surprise at all, is that wherever there are patient touch points with impact service quality, they figure up. And if you really do a rough count, sure, you can do statistical model, then there are plenty of them. About 39% of human touch points where a patient or a patient's family gets to interact with the entire, you know, workflow or the hospital environment, account for the factors which will drive patient choice, which is, again, obvious. It's a service industry. The quality of service experience drives the brand experience. But let me ask a question, and which may be a little bit of soul searching, saying, are hospital investments also aligned in the similar lines, right? I know, you know, 30-40% of healthcare, in certain cases, you see the employee cost count for 30-40% of the hospital's P&L. But incremental, that's a must have, right? That's a given, because those are the basic costs of doing business. But investments, if you are planning to protect your reputation, if you're planning to sort of grow your brand, if you plan to create a consistent brand experience, are you investing proportionately or disproportionately? I think the answer is there's a lot of disproportionate investment in hard assets, in technology, in infrastructure. There's a lot of investment in brand building and marketing promotion, more traditional ways. But really, investment in your basic core asset, which is going to drive your brand experience, is certainly lagging. I don't know if many will disagree in this forum. Now, the other question, which has repeatedly come to me in the last day and a half, you know, as was said in my introduction, I follow a lot of these developments in the digitization space, from what's happening in, you know, digitization of radiology, digitization of genomics, digitization of other omics, digitization of the core healthcare records. And recurrent themes from yesterday to today, I've been like excited about all the things that we've seen. But one critical part, again, saying how does your workforce, which is actually going to deliver the service, whether it's doctors or nurses, keep up with the evolving innovation landscape? Isn't the flow of innovation, what you learn at medical school, nursing school, the training that you get, and what you need to do, not just to use those technologies to deliver better care, but also if it's freed up time, and also to deliver more empathetic, more human care? Are we preparing our workforce for that, in terms of being in step, right? With all the exciting technologies and the digitization, obviously there's a lot of empowerment for patients, but still the critical care, it's called care because it's eventually delivered by humans, right? And this is not my, this is a very well accepted tenet. Now, the other interesting question I want to try and answer is saying, amongst all the other things, all the different confluence of technologies, convergence of IoT, AI, VR, how has skilling evolved independent of healthcare, right? And we know the answer to this. We see, this is outside healthcare, we see examples of great use of technology using blended learning, using AI and ML for personalized and adaptive learning, using very bite-sized nanobytes of learning, ongoing basis, to keep students' workforce engaged, using gamifications, using analytics and feedback at all stages to improve the quality of delivery of training and the effectiveness of training. Similar examples, you know, clearly people are aware of Khan Academy already, how digital's taken over K-12 in concept, how they flipped the classroom, taken theory out of the classroom. You do self-study when you're doing theory, and when you go to class, you do problem solving, right? So these are examples outside our domain, just to sort of broaden our horizon, saying what's the art of the possible when it comes to digital skilling, right? In terms of, you know, any general workplace, again, I've shown healthcare examples, but again, this is true for almost any workplace. You can transform one-off learning to everyday learning. You can, you know, say learning is an engagement, training is just an engagement strategy to keep my employees happy, rather than, you know, and also add essential skills. You can say soft skills, which are patient-facing soft skills for better patient experience, but also soft skills that develop the workforce for better resilience and developing a growth mindset, giving them more opportunities to grow. Let me cut to healthcare. You know, specifically, one example that we work closely with in terms of the RQI, which is a collaboration with Laerdal and American Heart Association. You know, when we started working with these groups more than 8 years ago, healthcare, the basic training, which was basic life support training, advanced cardiovascular life support training, used to be delivered in classrooms through print books. It used to be a two-year training. It used to be take 2 days to deliver this training. And it was what we'd call a low frequency training, right? Because once in 2 years, if you train, you really don't feel confident when the time comes for you to actually use those skills. What happened over the course of the next few years is that we building with, you know, with our partners, AHA and Laerdal built a simulation platform, which has a high frequency, low dose training. This is an instructor-less training, which gets completed online, the cognitive part, and the skill simulation gets in a lab in a hospital. And you know, this can be done every quarter instead of once in 2 years. This gives you precise feedback using sensors when you're getting the compression and everything right. This ties your theory scores back to your practical performance. Essentially, what this has done is change the way basic life support and ACLS training is delivered in the US. And we're proud that we partnered to build the underlying platform which brings these technologies together. And this is where our Medland story kind of started off. Since we had a great success in working with great partners and bringing these solutions to market in the healthcare sector, I think the time's ripe, and that's why Medland's now working on what we think are the imperative of skilling in the Indian healthcare sector. We've got, you know, outside those two names that I mentioned, we come from a background of digital. We were born digital from an ebook and e-learning platform more than two decades ago. And over the course of time, what inspired us to create this solution and this ecosystem platform were deep relationships with so many STEM providers or the medical content providers across the world. Our mission is to change healthcare in India and Asia by lifting the quality of training and skills provided to the healthcare workforce. This is our founding belief, that the quality of care can improve dramatically when hospitals invest in their most valuable assets, their employees, by giving them access to the best-in-class learning experiences. And we believe it's not just a question of reducing today's risk of errors, accidents, infections, complaints, although that's an obvious thing. It's also good for the hospital's business. It's also good for society's well-being. And this is our promise to the healthcare sector, that we'll bring world-class evidence-based knowledge, skills, and learning experience to hospitals and healthcare workers at a very affordable price. We will help hospitals meet today's challenges of risk, compliance, management, and operational efficiency. But we'll also help hospitals succeed in delivering tomorrow's promise. All the promises that are premised on all the nice, cool innovations that we talked about in bringing the best of digital technologies and bringing the best of empathetic care to the patients, and therefore building better patient outcomes, better experiences, and becoming trusted brands. And already, as we said in the introduction, we made a great start in the last year and a half. We're in 150 hospitals serving some of the best brands in this country. This is our core strategy for how we powering the adoption, because, you know, like inertia in technology adoption, there's a whole lot of inertia in almost every field of change, right? So we have this platform which is designed exclusively for hospitals. It's not a generic LMS. It takes into account hospital workflow, specific needs for hospital training, the environment training, and the upstream and downstream integration with different systems, whether it's performance management system, talent management systems, and other systems, sometimes it's quality systems. We have a partnership with world-class medical content, which we're trying to bring at the lowest possible cost, and which is a great thing for the Indian sector, because, you know, it just lifts up. We hear a lot about how the incoming batches, et cetera, the quality of training, the education that they receive in nursing is inconsistent. Sometimes it's great, sometimes it takes a much longer to get to the stage where they're productive and operational. That's one key value proposition. And we've created a strategy where we literally backup for the hospital training team. Some hospitals in our portfolio don't even have a dedicated learning department, but we have dedicated training experts and success managers who are regularly driving assessments, assignments, suggesting their benchmarking across what they see best practices. They're working with content publishers and everything else to make sure that the adoption is smooth and the engagement levels start high and remain high. This is something that we already brought in the Royal College of Nursing, Pedagogy, McGuire Healthcare, and we're soon bringing in other trusted brands to our content network. The overall argument is that Digital healthcare scaling, if you really break it down, it's not just about compliance or doing your paperwork, which is a must-have anyway. But you know, everything else has gone paperless. Training should have gone paperless way before. It is not that complicated. It brings a lot of efficiency. It brings a lot of productivity because your staff, your very valuable staff, is now taking much less time to come on board, and you feel confident about their skills. It makes a big impact on patient experience. It also, in these days, is very important, creates a very highly engaged workforce because, you know, one of the biggest things we've seen in the last year and a half is the amount of stress, both emotional and physical, that the healthcare staff has to deal with. And being able to invest back in them, not just in, you know, technical skills or staying up on the job, but also to be able to manage themselves, soft skills to manage their stress, to manage teamwork, collaboration. A lot of that goes to it being an engaged workforce. And that's also something that these days is so much more easily possible with digital skilling platforms. Finally, some of the things that we're working on, as we said, we're dedicated to this sector. And these are the goals. We talked about brand, and was not just a connection to sort of force connection. These are the typical brand, and many hospitals today don't even measure this, but we're working collaboratively with some of our partners, some of our early adopters, to see where they have the need to understand how training can help improve these outcome parameters, all these metrics, whether they're quality indicators, business growth indicators, patient feedback, performance and competency metrics at the employee level. So a lot of these things, as we said, this is a sector which is brand new. This is a sector which needs a lot of help in adoption. And this is also a sector which will, you know, is driven by a lot of rational considerations. Am I getting the ROI in this? What's the impact? How do I measure this? And it takes two, and we've taken the first few steps and working collaboratively to develop a much stronger foundation for the business rationale and outcomes. So how digital training or digital skilling can drive better brand outcomes in the sector. With that, I'm going to stop.
Thank you, Deepak. Appreciate it. Glad to see that, you know, you've taken the initiative of driving something which normally takes a backseat in hospitals. I think it's the right time that hospitals start focusing on continuous skilling. Thank you very much.